Good afternoon. In this video lecture, I'm going to talk about TI plasmid based vectors and their use in plant genetic engineering. This is the third lecture in the cloning vector series of lectures that I had been doing in last couple of weeks. In the first lecture, we talked about plasmid vectors and then we shifted to phage vectors and their hybrid versions like cosmids and phagemids. And we also talked about the high capacity cloning vectors like YAC and BAC. So this TI plasmid vectors, it required a separate treatment, and so I made it a separate lecture for that. TI plasmid, it stands for tumor inducing plasmid, and this particular plasmid is found in a soil bacterium called Agrobacterium tumefaciens. There are several species of this Agrobacterium, Agrobacterium ruby and Agrobacterium rhizogenes. All of them harbor this kind of TI plasmid, which is a quite big plasmid. It is an extra chromosomal DNA element. The bacteria has its own chromosome, which there are two pieces of chromosome. In fact, one is the circular DNA molecule and another is the linear one. So this bacterium causes a gall formation, crown gall disease that is called in dicotyledonous plants. And this is because of this plasmid. This plasmid contains, if you see the map of it, it contains a DNA segment called tDNA, because this region is transferred to the host cell, and this particular region contains genes for the biosynthesis of phytohormones like auxins and cytokinins, and there are some other genes which are responsible for the synthesis of opines. Opines are different types of amino acids and some sugar derivatives, which are only expressed when this DNA segment is transferred to the host. And the bacterium benefits by this mechanism, that these opines are expressed in the eukaryotic cells only. These opine genes have a structure. They have the promoter for the eukaryotic system, and there are polyadenylation sites that is also eukaryotic in nature, and that's why this is not expressed in the bacterial system. So to induce the plant cell to synthesize opines, the bacterium transfers this tDNA into the host cell. This is the purpose of the bacteria, why it gets associated with the plant cell for this gall formation. And because the bacterium doesn't enter into the cell, it only transfers this tDNA element, and it does this to just tell it to synthesize the opines for its growth, nutrition and growth. And the other genes that are present and structural portions of this TI plasmid include this vir region, this virulence region or vir region. This region contains 6 to 8 genes that are responsible for the transfer of this tDNA. So the products of these genes, 6 to 8 genes depending on particular strain type, the number may vary, but their function is to replicate this tDNA portion and then to generate pores within the bacterium and the plant cell so that the DNA can be transferred, and to escort the DNA, because it is single stranded DNA, so it can be clipped exonucleolytically. So it is escorted by one of the vir gene product, that is vir e, to the host cell, where it gets implanted into the plant genome, and then there it expresses these phytohormone genes, because of which what happens, the plant cell divides more and more, and it forms a tumorous growth like this. So now this is the characteristic of the TI plasmid. So how this can be used as a vector? This tDNA region, it allows you, it gives you facility that if you replace this with your desired gene, that will also get transferred to the host cell. That's the thing. So, and one thing more, that the two ends of this tDNA element that are bordered by the left border and right border, 25 base pair repeat elements, those are mainly necessary for the transfer of this tDNA, and the inner region, particularly the phytohormone genes, are not required for the transfer, neither the opine genes. So the entire DNA can be replaced by your gene of interest, but scientists did they deleted this tumorigenic portion, that is the phytohormone genes, the genes responsible for the auxin and biosynthesis. They removed that portion, and this kind of vector, and they designed a vector which did not have this auxin and cytokine and biosynthesis gene. This type of TI plasmid vectors are called disarmed TI plasmids. Okay, this gene of interest is inserted particularly near this opine synthesis gene. The promoter of nopaline synthesis is located somewhere here. So if you incorporate your gene just after that, downstream of the promoter of the nopaline synthesis gene, then that gene will get expressed in the host plant also. And if I go to the previous slide, the opine amino acids and the sugar derivatives that are formed are metabolized by some genes which are called opine catabolism genes, which are located in the outside this tDNA element. So this is how these opine genes, opine catabolism genes are, can utilize those opines for the growth of the bacterium over there. So you can introduce your gene of interest just after the promoter element of nopaline synthase or octopine synthase, whatever the case may be. So this is your recombinant DNA. There are two types of vector designed on the basis of the location of the vir region, because this vir region is required for the transfer of the tDNA, and it, because it synthesizes some proteins only, vir region, the genes of the vir region, they synthesize, they are not the binding site of any protein that will come and associate and then will transfer the tDNA element. They are simply, they synthesize some proteins which help in the transfer of the tDNA. So proteins are diffusible elements, and so the vir region does not require to be present in cis orientation all the time in the plasmid. So on that basis, there are two versions of this vector. One is called co-integrate vector, which is which has the vir region in cis orientation with the tDNA element. That means in the same plasmid you get the vir as well as the tDNA element. And in the binary vectors, this vir region and the tDNA elements are in separate plasmids. That's why the name is binary. However, since the when you are keeping them in a cis position, the plasmid size is very, very big, so you require an smaller size plasmids in which you can do your cloning. And this plasmid has an origin of replication for Escherichia coli, and here also you have a left border and right border, and the tDNA element present with some markers like NPT2, which is kanamycin resistant marker. There is nopaline synthase gene, there is promoter for the this is nopaline synthase A, this is the promoter for the nopaline synthase, and there are multiple cloning sites, so you can clone your gene of interest somewhere here in the multiple cloning site, and your promoter will express that gene. But this, after cloning into this this plasmid in Escherichia coli, this DNA is transferred to the agrobacterium which harbors this this co-integrate vector. Now, after the transfer of this plasmid into the agrobacterium tumefaciens, it undergoes a site-specific recombination, and it introduces itself or incorporates itself into the TI plasmid that was already present in the agrobacterium, and now a co-integrate is synthesized or created. This co-integrate will transfer the DNA element from the right border to left border into the plant, and thereby transferring the gene of interest that you have cloned somewhere here. So this is the way how co-integrate vectors work. Binary vector, you clone your gene of interest in this plasmid which contains the tDNA element, and this particular plasmid has a origin of replication which has a broad host range origin of replication. In fact, that means it can survive or can be maintained in E. coli as well as in agrobacterium tumefaciens. So you do your cloning part in the E. coli, and then you transfer this plasmid into the agrobacterium tumefaciens, which already have this plasmid which contains the vir region. So now these two plasmids are present in the agrobacterium, and they don't recombine, like the unlike this one co-integrate one. They remain independently because there is no homologous region between them. So what happens with the help of this vir region, the tDNA element is transferred to the plant cell. When you allow the agrobacterium tumefaciens to infect plant tissue like leaf discs, then this particular tDNA region will get transferred to the host cell, and there it will get implanted in the genome, and the gene expression will occur. So this is how binary vectors work. These kind of vectors, which have a broad host range origin of replication and can be maintained in two different hosts like the E. coli and the agrobacterium, are called shuttle vectors. So this is what shuttle vector is about. Now, about the methodology, how it is being done. So you can see this, the simplified diagram is this, that you need to have the agrobacterium tumefaciens culture. From there, you purify the plasmid, that is TI plasmid. It may be the co-integrate version, or it may be the binary, whatever, but you need to do the cloning first. And that means if it is the co-integrate vector, then you require the intermediate plasmid, which is growing in the Escherichia coli. From there, you have to isolate it and then cleave it with a restriction endonuclease, and your gene of interest has to be produced by the same restriction endonuclease, and both of them has to be ligated, and your recombinant DNA is then ready. If you are using a binary vector, then you need to have that TI plasmid without the vir region, that is the binary plasmid, shuttle plasmid. In that, you do your cloning. So your clone is ready. Now you transfer that into the agrobacterium tumefaciens. And if it is co-integrate vector, then the intermediate plasmid will recombine with the TI plasmid. Or if it is a binary vector, it will not recombine. It will remain within the host cell separately. The vir region containing plasmid will remain separately. So ultimately, when you allow this bacterium to infect a host cell, it will transfer the tDNA element, and that will get implanted in the plant cell, and you can select that plant cell by augmenting the media with different kinds of antibiotic, which makes this cell resistant. And so this clone is being, it can be regenerated in tissue culture, and you can develop plantlets and plants from there. That those are transgenic plants, basically. So this is the strategy, and it is done using leaf disc method. So you get the leaf discs of the plant in which you want to transform your tDNA and your gene of interest. So you allow your bacterium to grow together with the leaf discs in agar plates, and same thing happens. The tDNA gets implanted into the cell. Some of the cells, the marginal cells, they later grow and divide, and then you change the medium. You allow you add the hormones like cytokinin and auxin, and change the ratio of that hormone to generate root and shoot, etc. And then after the plantlets have developed, they are subjected to hardening, and then they are brought to fields. These are transgenic plants. This is how the TI plasmid is used to generate transgenic plants. So some of the examples or success stories of transgenesis are here. The first transgenic plant was produced in 1983 by Louis Herrera Estrella, De Picker, Montague and Shell. And this paper was published in Nature that time, because it was a epoch-making discovery, of course, that they expressed a chimeric gene that was transferred into the plant cells using this TI plasmid for the first time. What they did, they simply cloned the octopine synthase gene. The octopine synthase is the part of the TI plasmid. So they took this octopine synthase and they cloned it near the nopaline synthase, just after the promoter of the nopaline synthase gene. And it was a in fact in a chimeric way, because it contained a fusion gene that is called chloramphenicol acetyl transferase as a reporter gene. There is a CAT assay by which they can understand whether this gene expression has occurred or not. So they found this successfully done, as CAT assay was positive, indicating that the gene transfer had been done. The southern blot, northern blot, etc. were also done to confirm the experimentation. The next gene transport or transgenic experiment was using the reporter gene, that is lysophorase. And this is a tobacco plant in which this is glowing tobacco plant. You can see the photograph. And in this autoluminescent tobacco, what has been done? The luciferase gene from the firefly has been cloned into it using this TI plasmid. This was published in Science in 1986. So although the fluorescence that was produced was little less, and so it required a little more exposure of the photographic film, but ultimately it was there, of course, reporting that the transfer of the gene is successful. There are some commercial crops that have been genetically modified and that have been brought into field. This one is the flavr-savr tomatoes. In this case, antisense RNA technology has been done to switch off the expression of a gene that is responsible for the bruisiness or the softness of the tomato or different kinds of fruits, in all fruits, the polygalacturonase. This is the enzyme that actually dissolves the polygalacturonic acid, the middle lamella, that is also called pectic substance of the cell walls, and the fruit becomes pulpy. The cell wall, the outer sheath of the fruit also becomes, the skin of the fruit also becomes pulpy because of the dissolution of that polygalacturonic acid. So polygalacturonase is the enzyme. So if you somehow block the expression of the polygalacturonase, and that can be done by antisense RNA technology, and that was done way back in 1990s, and these kind of tomatoes, plasmid tomatoes, they are known. They were created or produced. This is BT cotton. It was brought into market in 2002, also in India, by an American company called Monsanto. In this plant, they have transferred a gene called Cry gene, which produces a crystalline protein in a bacterium called Bacillus thuringiensis. This bacterium is a bioinsecticide because the bacterium, at the time of its endospore formation, it synthesizes this crystalline protein, which is an endotoxin. So when an insect engulfs this bacterium, they also engulf the endotoxin protein, and the endotoxin within their gut, they go and they cleave into two parts. One of the protein goes and forms pores within the cell linings of the gut. So there they create imbalance of salt, and because of which water also, the osmosis and diffusion process is affected, and ultimately an indigestion takes place in the insects and they die. So this way the insect is killed. So scientists thought that rather than using the BT Bacillus thuringiensis, let us transfer that particular gene, Cry gene, into the plant so that it becomes itself resistant with the insect. So this BT cotton is resistant to the bollworm. This was the concept. And this is golden rice. In this case, they have transferred the beta carotene gene in the rice, so that rice, the carotene content of the rice will increase, and because of which the yellow color is there, that is called golden rice. This was done with an idea that the third world country uses rice as a main food or principal food. So, and they have a deficiency of vitamin A, which is produced from carotene. So if they get carotene as a supplement along with this rice, this will probably remove this vitamin deficiency in the population. So these were the some success stories regarding the TI plasmid and gene transfer in plants. So I believe that I will talk about all of them in some separate lecture, because they need some separate treatment, how it was done, the methodology behind that, those things, particularly this flavr-savr tomatoes, BT cotton or BT brinjal, and this golden rice. So I'm ending this lecture over here, and thank you very much. I will request you to share this video and press the like button also, and subscribe this channel and press the bell icon so that you get notification for next videos or future videos that I'll be making on such types of topics.